Okay, so today is the fourth video about quantum symmetries and quantum arithmetic. The three previous videos was about von Neumann algebra, subfactor, and planar algebra, and today we will talk about quantum arithmetic. So here we see quantum arithmetic as a marriage between arithmetic and quantum algebra. This is the slogan of the subject. More precisely, in this talk, we will generalize in the framework of subfactor planar algebra the notion of prime and natural number. We will generalize the Hoare's theorem about cyclic group. We will also generalize Euler's Toussaint function on the natural number. And finally, Brown's conjecture on finite group. And we will provide application to representation theory of finite group. And the last two slides of the talk will mention a quantum generalization of the Riemann hypothesis in this framework, which is in some sense very funny. Very interesting, very funny. Not so much work about that. What is interesting is that there is a natural way in the subfactor planar algebra framework to generalize the Riemann hypothesis. And I will mention that. Okay. So first, the starting point about quantum arithmetic is maximal subfactor planar algebra. So what about that? Let P be the subfactor planar algebra of the subfactor N in M. Let A, B, C be three by projection with A less than or equal to B, less than or equal to C. And let N in P, in Q, in R, in M be the corresponding intermediate subfactor. So Q corresponds to A, no, sorry, P corresponds to A, Q corresponds to B, and R corresponds to C. And let's define the index of the biprojection A in B to be the index of P in Q. So by Jones index theorem, such index, so it is exactly the index of a subfactor, so must be in this set. And also by subfactor theory, the index of biprojection defined like that is multiplicative with the intermediate. For the same reason than for subfactor. This is exactly the same thing. So we have these two statements. And from these two statements, we can make a kind of sheaf of Eratosthenes. As this is done for the prime number. So the sheaf of Eratosthenes is a way to get the prime number from the list of natural numbers, and we can, in some sense, apply such algorithm to subfactor planar algebra using these two statements. So if the index of the subfactor planar algebra, which is denoted like that, the index of E1 in identity, if this index is in the set S, the discrete part, the countable part, accumulating to 4. If it is there, or if it is in the open interval 4, 8, from which we remove the double of the element of S and alpha beta with alpha equal that and beta equal that, this product. If we remove that, then the biprojection lattice of the subfactor must be equal to that. They cannot have any intermediate. Exactly as for prime number, in fact. There is no room for intermediate. This is just an observation. You apply these two statements, and you see there is no room for any intermediate biprojection. Such a subfactor planar algebra without intermediate is called maximal. This name comes from Dietmar Bisch in subfactor theory. So a subfactor planar algebra is called maximal if its biprojection lattice reduces to this trivial lattice with two elements, the Jones projection E1 and the identity. In that sense, this looks like as the prime number, but in fact, this is an extension. The maximal subfactor planar algebra, the set of maximal subfactor planar algebra is exactly an extension of the set of prime number. It's a big extension. We will see later there is a smaller extension if we reduce to depth 2. But maximal subfactor planar algebra are, in some sense, quantum analogous of prime number. Quantum analogous and extension. We recover all the prime by considering the group subfactor planar algebra for the cyclic group of prime order. So this provides you a subfactor planar algebra of index P. And as we said, the group subfactor planar algebra is exactly the group, no more, no less data. So the group subfactor planar algebra for the cyclic group of order P, in some sense, is exactly the prime number, no more, no less. But we can, from group theory and group subfactor planar algebra, we can make other kind of maximal subfactor. In fact, any maximal inclusion of group, like this two symmetric group Sn minus 1 inside Sn, it's a maximal inclusion, provide a maximal subfactor planar algebra, because we know now that there is a Galois correspondence between the intermediate subfactor planar algebra, the intermediate biprojection, and the intermediate subgroup. So here there is no intermediate subgroup, it's a maximal inclusion. So this provides a maximal subfactor planar algebra. same thing for any maximal inclusion of group. This is in some sense classified, but what is called primitive group, primitive permutation. So here, these are some examples of integral index. Here we see that every subfactor plan algebra of index less than 4 are maximal, because in fact this is the observation here. S contain all the possible index less than 4. So the classification we saw in one last video, every subfactor plan algebra are maximal. They are all maximal for every subfactor plan algebra of index less than 4. There is no intermediate. And for index between 4 and 5 plus square root of 3, there are exactly 12 subfactor plan algebra maximal, assuming irreducible and finite depth. There are 12 ones up to dual. And the first one is the Hagerup subfactor. So there is a lot of examples. The notion of maximal subfactor planar algebra is a notion which contains a lot of examples. So the prime number, but also coming from group subgroup, and lot of examples with non-integral index. So there are many, many examples. Now, this generalizes the notion of prime number. But what about the natural number? Okay, we can generalize the prime number using the notion of maximal subfactor planar algebra. But is it possible to generalize the notion of natural number to subfactor planar algebra? Here are necessary conditions for a good definition D of what should be the generalization of the natural number to the subfactor planar algebra. So a good definition should satisfy that these two subfactor planar algebra, group, finite group subfactor planar algebra, the fixed point or the cross product, should satisfy the expected definition if and only if the group is cyclic. The natural number, in fact, in the group world correspond exactly to the cyclic group. The cyclic group represents exactly the natural number. So, to have a good definition, we want that the group subfactor plan algebra, as we said, which is exactly the group, no more, no less, we want it in such subfactor plan algebra are satisfy the expected definition if and only if the group is itself cyclic. So this is the first necessary condition for a good definition. The second necessary condition for a good definition is that what we said in the previous slide should be kept here. So the maximal subfactor plan algebra generalizes the notion of prime number. So in particular, for our generalization of the notion of natural number, every maximal subfactor plan algebra should satisfy this expected definition. So if we find a natural definition satisfying these two conditions, then this will be a good definition. So here it's a theorem due to Hochstein-Ohr, proved in 38. This theorem says that a finite group is cyclic if and only if its subgroup lattice is distributive. Aha! So we have a combinatorial way to characterize the cyclic group among all the finite group. This theorem is not so hard to prove, but it is also not so well known. And in my opinion, this theorem is very interesting. This is very deep. There is a complete characterization of the notion of cyclic group in a purely combinatorial way. This is very interesting. In fact, there is a whole subject in algebraic combinatorics. Some people work on providing complete characterization of notion of coming from group, such that cyclic or abelian or nilpotent solvable, using combinatorial property like that, lattice, or the lattice of the group with product with itself several times. In fact, it's also a conjecture that if you take a finite group, and you make the product of this finite group with itself, so G times G times G times G, it's a conjecture that if you do that, so G power N, for N large enough, then the lattice of G power N remember the group G for N large enough. It's a conjecture. It's an open problem in algebraic combinatorics. So anyway, here, this is one of the easiest such result. Cyclic groups are completely characterized among the group, at least finite group. There is also a generalization of that for infinite group. But here we're interested in finite group. So among the finite group, the cyclic group are completely characterized using the subgroup lattice. So we will, in the next slide, we will recall what is the lattice. We will give some more details about that. But for this slide, let's say that so a lattice is distributive if so you have two, you have a join and a meet. So these two operations should distribute each other as follows. So this is distributive lattice, and in the next slides, we will provide more details about what is a lattice. What is a distributive lattice, a Boolean lattice, many, many more details. So, the definition, the biprojection lattice is distributive, seems to be the good definition we are looking for. In fact, it satisfies the first property by applying the Ohr's theorem. In fact, if we restrict to the group subfactor with a distributive biprojection lattice. If you apply The Galois correspondence then, this imply that the subgroup lattice is distributive. And if you apply Hoare's theorem, then this implies that the group is cyclic. And in fact, it's an equivalence. If and only if. So one is satisfied. So this is nice. What about two? Two, in fact, a maximal subfactor plane algebra, by definition, there is no intermediate by projection between E1 and identity. So the lattice is just the lattice of two elements, which is obviously distributive. This is called the Boolean lattice of rank one. So this is obviously, it obviously satisfies this assumption. So let's call distributive a subfactor planar algebra if its by projection lattice is distributive. This is our good definition generalizing the notion of natural number. This is very interesting, very nice. In my opinion, there is a huge potential about such object in the studying of such object. In some sense, quantum arithmetic is, the goal of quantum arithmetic is to generalize result coming from arithmetic of natural number to distributive subfactor planar algebra. And we will explain one example of such, in fact, several examples of such generalization through what we called through the Hoare's theorem, the Euler-Totschen function, Brown conjecture, and at the end, we will also mention the Riemann hypothesis. So let's provide some recall about lattice theory. So a lattice is a partially ordered set called poset, partially ordered set, poset L, in which every two elements, A, B, have a unique supremum or join, denoted A join B, and a unique infimum or meet called, denoted A meet B, like that. So these two posets are lattice. This one is not. Why? This is a poset. So the order, a poset, there is an order, a partial order. The order corresponds to this edge. So A is greater than B. So two elements, A is greater than B, if and only if there is an edge like that, and B is above. So A is greater than B, C is greater than E, etc. So this is poset. You can see that this is a lattice because there is a unique, this one has been found, there is a unique supremum, a unique infimum, etc. You can check everything, but here we see this is not a lattice because C, D and E do not have a unique supremum. C is a supremum of D and E, but B is also a supremum of D and E. So this lattice is, this poset, sorry, this poset is not a lattice. So the lattice theory is not so straightforward. You have to be careful. You cannot just draw some diagram like that and call that a lattice. No. You have to satisfy some assumption These two are lattices. This one is not. The set of subgroups, so as we already said, the set of subgroups form a lattice denoted LG, the subgroup lattice. The partial order is the inclusion. The join of two subgroups is the subgroup generated by these two subgroups. And the meet is the intersection. Here are two examples of subgroup lattice. You take the group of cyclic, the cyclic group of order 6. You get this lattice. Here is the symmetric group S3. You get this lattice. A sublattice of the lattice L is just a subset of L such that the subset L prime, such that L prime mid join, the same mid join than here, is also a lattice. So you have a sublattice like that. For example, here, this part is a sublattice. If you take two elements of the lattice, two elements AB with A less than or equal to B, you can define the interval AB to be the sublattice of all the elements of L which are between A and B. For example, if you start from the subgroup lattice of the symmetric group S4 and you consider the subgroup S2, you can make this interval. This is an interval in the subgroup lattice of S4. This is the interval AB with A equal S2, B equal S4. So every finite lattice is bounded. It's easy to see from the definition. It's straightforward because every element has a supremum and an infimum. So by finiteness, a finite lattice must be bounded. Admit a minimum and a maximum denoted 0 hat and 1 hat. So 1 hat, 0 hat, the maximum, the minimum. The atom of a lattice, finite lattice, is the set of minima of the poset L from which you remove 0 at. So we take, for example, this lattice, we remove 0 at, and the minima are this one and this one. By definition, this is the atom. And same thing, the coatom are the maxima of the poset from which we remove 1 hat. So C1, C2 are the coatom of the lattice. So if we consider let B define B as the join of all the atoms. Here we have two atoms. The join is B here, but you can have several more than two atoms. And the join of all the two atoms, let's call it B. And let's call T the meet of all the coatoms. Here, the meet of C1, C2 is this one T. Same, in general, you can have several more than two coatoms. And so you take the meet. For example, you can have also one. Here you have one atom, one coatom, and here the meet equals the join of the meet. No, sorry. The join of the atom was equal to the meet of its coatom. This is the same, but in general, so they are different. So let's call the interval 0 at B to be the bottom interval and T1 hat the top interval. Okay, so here I re-put the definition of a distributive lattice. We already see in some previous slide. So a lattice L is distributive if the join and meet operation distribute over each other, which means that for every ABC, A meet B join C equal A meet B join A meet C. Here are two examples of lattice. The one on the left is not distributive. The two on the right are distributive. So let's see why the one on the left is not distributive. So, do the operation A meet B join C? B join C. Is this one. And you make the meet with A, you come back to A. So A meet B join C is A. But if you apply that now, A join B meet A join C. A join B is C1. A join C is C1. C1 meet C1 is C1. So here, C1, here we denoted the trivial subgroup 1. So on the left, you have A. On the right, you have C1. So this is different. So the lattice is not distributive. And here we can check, you can check that every such operation, we can check that the meet and join distribute over each other. Okay. So let's mention here that the class of distributive lattice is stable by sublattice or reverse. If you have a distributive lattice, if you take any sublattice, it's also distributive. And if you take the reverse, so if you reverse the picture from top to bottom, distributive, so this also keep the distributivity. So then we see that what we defined before, distributive subfactor planar algebra, according to that, The distributive subfactor plane algebra is stable by intermediate and dual. In fact, here, for intermediate, we only need sublattice is too much. We only need to be stable by interval. In fact, because intermediate corresponds to an interval. But so in particular for interval. So the if you have a distributive subfactor plane algebra, any intermediate subfactor plane algebra, so the subfactor plane algebra corresponding to an intermediate subfactor, there is a way to define the notion of intermediate subfactor planar algebra directly in term in the framework of planar algebra. This is due to first to Landau and then to Bakshi. This way to define the notion of intermediate in the framework, directly in the framework of subfactor planar algebra. So here, the class of distributive subfactor planar algebra is stable by intermediate and by dual, or by dual. They are stable by these two operations. So this class of distributive subfactor planar algebra is quite natural and very natural operation. Keep so this class is natural in the sense, also in the sense that it is stable by such natural operation. So a distributive bounded lattice is called Boolean if any element A admit a unique complement denoted A complement, A power C, like that. And what do we mean by complement? We mean that A join A complement is 0 hat and A meet A complement is 1 hat. This is an example of Boolean. So do we discuss that later? Yeah. So this is an example of Boolean. You have, if you take A equals C2, and A complement is C15. Because C2 meet C15, you see that the minimal, the infimum of this and this is C1, so 0 hat, and the supremum of this and this is C30, so 1 hat. And you can check for every element. Every element has a unique, and it is unique, and it is unique for, you can check for every element, there is a unique complement, a unique such complement. This is a Boolean lattice. So in fact, any finite Boolean lattice is isomorphic to some lattice denoted B index N, the subset lattice of the finite set 1, 2, 3, up to N, with union and intersection. Here it's B3, so the set 1, 2, 3. So this is all the subset with union intersection for join and meet, and ordered by the inclusion, of course. So you see this B3 here. So Birkhoff representation theorem states that a finite lattice is distributive if and only if it embeds into some Boolean lattice, Bn. So we said Boolean of rank n. So you can have, in fact, many variety, many shape, many possible active or distributive lattice. And in some sense, the Boolean lattice are quite uniform, quite uniform. Yeah. But you can, any finite lattice is a sublattice of some BN. So this is good, in fact. A lattice is called top Boolean if its top interval, as defined here, is Boolean, and is called bottom Boolean if its bottom interval is Boolean. Here it's an example of bottom Boolean interval, which is also top Boolean. It's bottom Boolean because you see that its bottom interval in red here is Boolean. It is the Boolean, it is isomorphic to the Boolean lattice of rank 2, B2, which is here. Okay. And as a corollary of that, a finite distributive lattice is top and bottom Boolean. But this is distributive also. This top and bottom Boolean. Any finite distributive lattice is top, is both top and bottom Boolean. And this, we will use this later. Okay. So our theorem says that a finite group. So okay, this is the end of the recall about lattice theory. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 slides about lattice theory. So let's come back to our theorem. So our theorem says that a finite group is cyclic if and only if its subgroup lattice is distributive. So cyclic means singly generated. It's a group generated by one element. Okay. And we define a distributive subfactor planar algebra as a subfactor planar algebra with a distributive by projection lattice. This is okay, but now the question is, in what sense a distributive subfactor planar algebra is singly generated? So is there a way to generalize the our theorem? Can we find a way? Can we a sense for singly generated for a subfactor planar algebra such that the distributive subfactor planar algebra are singly generated? So this will be a generalization of one way of our theorem. Let's first look at the group subgroup case. And in fact, Hochstein-Ohr already looked to the group subgroup case here, interval. So consider an interval of finite group. It will be called H cyclic, or weakly cyclic, in fact. There are two definitions in the literature. We can say H cyclic, where H corresponds to here, so relative. So it's cyclic relatively to H. And we will see later that in the framework of subfactor planar algebra, this is called W cyclic for weakly cyclic. So we can say it's weakly cyclic or H cyclic or cyclic relatively to H, but I prefer the name weakly cyclic. So if it's so, there is a coset generating H coset generating G. So it makes sense. It's cyclic relatively to H because in fact, this is equal to the group generated by H and G. So relatively to H, G is cyclic relatively to H. It is H cyclic. Or in the framework of coset, it is singly generated in the sense that it is generated by a single H coset. So, okay. And in fact, the Hochstein-Ohr already proved a generalization of one way of his theorem using this notion. So he proved that for distributive interval, so Hochstein-Ohr said that a distributive interval is H cyclic. The distributive interval of finite group HG is H cyclic, and I generalize this theorem to top Boolean interval. Top Boolean, any distributive like this is top Boolean, and in fact, it is very natural. And to, in fact, this is the easiest way to prove that. To prove that. So here is the proof with top Boolean. So you prove that first. To prove that, you need, there are three claims. So first, this is true in the maximal case. So this is straightforward. If you are in the maximal case, what does this mean? So M is maximal in G. So if you take any element of G which is not in M and you generalize the group generated by this element and M must be G because it is maximal, M is maximal. So if you add something, this will generate everything by definition of maximal. So this is obviously true. The more interesting case is this case. In fact, so this is easy but not immediate. This cannot be proved in one line. This requires some half a page, in fact, to prove that. So a Boolean interval is H cyclic or weakly cyclic. So if HG is Boolean, then this interval is H cyclic or weakly cyclic in that sense. And we can reduce to the top interval. In fact, the third point said that if you have if HG is H cyclic, then so is top interval. This top interval is T cyclic. So if this is weakly cyclic, then the top interval of that is also weakly cyclic in that sense. So, so using that, the proof for distributive interval reduced to prove for top Boolean and so to Boolean. Everything reduced to Boolean. So in fact, the notion for such result, the fundamental property is Boolean. This is the key notion, Boolean. Everything reduced to Boolean. Okay, so top Boolean imply weakly cyclic, H cyclic. So, but the converse is false, unfortunately. Unfortunately, the converse is false if you consider this interval. In fact, you can see that it is, this is S2 cyclic, this is weakly cyclic, but not top Boolean. In fact, we already draw the lattice for that. It is here. You see that this is not Boolean because it is not distributive. You just need to apply this argument here. But you can observe, you can see that it is weakly cyclic. So the converse is false. And in fact, it's an open problem. What should be the converse of what is the full relative generalization of Horst's theorem? Here, it's a generalization only one way. But what should be the generalization of the other way? It's an open problem. What we do here for subfactor plane algebra, we will generalize this relative version to subfactor plane algebra. And it's also an open problem how to generalize the equivalence to subfactor plane algebra. This is an interesting problem. This is such a problem, in fact, nobody considered before. So, lot of new stuff can be found in such problem. Very interesting. So, here, this is what I called so H cyclic or weakly cyclic. So, what is weakly cyclic? In fact, there is a way to define weakly cyclic, which exactly generalize this notion for interval of finite group. A subfactor plane algebra is called weakly cyclic, denoted W cyclic, if there is a minimal projection in the two-box space, which generate the identity. So we already see in the previous video how to generate a biprojection from a positive element. We use the co-product. This was this. So you can go to the previous video. That is the way to define the biprojection generated by one positive element. If there is a minimal projection, this is important. You cannot take any projection. Otherwise, you just take ID. This is a projection. It generates itself. No. If there is a minimal projection generating the identity by projection, which is the biggest, this is one hat of the biprojection lattice, such subfactor plane algebra is called weakly cyclic. And theorem. A distributive subfactor plane algebra is weakly cyclic. So this is a first step in this question, in what sense a distributive subfactor plane algebra is singly generated. It is weakly cyclic. So it is singly generated in the sense that there is a minimal projection generating the identity by projection. But it is not completely satisfying because the converse is not true, because this is equivalent to, in the group subgroup case, this is equivalent to that, and we see that the converse is not true. So, weakly cyclic is too weak, in fact. In another paper, I define a notion of cyclic subfactor planar algebra. But it is also not enough, in fact. So, this, how to say? This is too weak. There is a, so this part, it's also, yeah, this is an open problem, how to provide a stronger version of singly generated, such that you get an equivalence with distributive by projection lattice. So this is the first step. So we have this first step, but it's an open problem, and this is, in my opinion, very interesting, how to find a stronger version of that. You can play, in fact, it's a framework in which you can play. You can play with minimal projection. You can say, okay, some extra properties, blah, 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 blah. How to make something which is equivalent to distributive subfactor plane algebra. In fact, when I talk about some paper I wrote, what I called cyclic, it's not a stronger version of that. In fact, it's a weaker version. It's a stronger version of distributive. What I called cyclic in the first paper I published on this subject, it's distributive with an extra assumption saying that all the intermediates are normal in some sense, which means the biprojections are central, bicentral, in fact. But this is because I was not able to prove that in the first paper, so I added an extra assumption to that to prove this. So I proved a weaker version of this theorem in a previous paper published in 2 years before by adding an extra assumption to that. And but then now there is now it is proved for any distributive subfactor plane algebra is weakly cyclic. But as I said, this is not completely satisfying. We need to find a stronger version of that, which will be equivalent to that. Anyway, so it is proved, in fact, as here, with the sweet claim. In fact, to be exact, in fact, this is here. Here we mimic what we've done here. This was done first at the level of subfactor plane algebra with these three claims, and then we translated this in the group theoretical framework, and we get this proof with these three claims. And this was done first at the level of subfactor plane algebra. Same structure of proof. True for maximal, true for Boolean, and then you reduce to top interval. So, okay, weakly cyclic. So we have this notion, which is quite natural, quite easy to state. So what does this notion mean in particular? As I already said, this notion recovers the notion of H cyclic I mentioned before. So a group subgroup subfactor plane algebra, the cross product case, is weakly cyclic if and only if the interval is H cyclic, the interval HG is H cyclic. So this is not surprising, because this is the exact generalization. So there is no problem, in fact. What is more interesting here is, what about the fixed point subfactor plane algebra? And we will see the group subgroup in the fixed point case later, but what about the fixed point? The fixed point subfactor planar algebra is weakly cyclic if and only if G is linearly primitive. Aha. So here you have something interesting. What is linearly primitive is a property of representation of the group. So here we are very happy because we get now we deal with representation. Linearly primitive means that the group admit a faithful, irreducible, complex representation. So the fixed point subfactor planar algebra for a group, this is weakly cyclic if and only if the group admit a faithful, irreducible, complex representation. In particular, it's easy to see that every finite simple group is linearly primitive. So if you put here a finite simple group, what you get is weakly cyclic. And it's a result that a group with a non-cyclic center cannot have a faithful, irreducible, complex representation. A group with a non-cyclic center is not linearly primitive. In particular, any non-cyclic abelian group is not linearly primitive. What about the group subgroup subfactor planar algebra in the fixed point case? So to reformulate the weakly cyclic in the group theoretical framework for interval, we need to introduce these two notions, fixed point subspace and pointwise stabilizer subgroup. So let W be a representation of the group G. Let K be a subgroup of G. Let X be a subspace of W. The fixed point W power K, the fixed point subspace of W power K, is the set of vector W such that KW equal W for all K in K. So the fixed point subspace. And the pointwise stabilizer subgroup, G index X between two parentheses, is the set of element of J such that JX equal X for all X in X. So be careful here. There are two similar notions. You have this is the pointwise stabilizer subgroup. But you also have the stabilizer subgroup, which usually is denoted X, G index X without parentheses. And this, if there is no parenthesis, the stabilizer subgroup, which is not the pointwise one, is here, it's not for, so it is for all X in X, GX is in the big X. But here, this is a pointwise stabilizer subgroup, so you have to be careful. Here it's pointwise. So for all small x, gx equal x for all small x. And you need this notation with the parenthesis. So note that G is linearly primitive if and only if, so there is an irreducible, faithful, complex representation. If and only if G, so this G index V like that, the pointwise stabilizer group for V is one, because look that this is exactly the kernel of V according to the definition. So faithful mean trivial kernel. So this is exactly so irreducible with a trivial kernel, which means faithful. So linearly primitive is exactly that. And the relative version of that will deal with some H somewhere, in fact. So let so the group subgroups of factor plan algebra for the fixed point. This is weakly cyclic if and only if there is an irreducible complex representation of G, such that the pointwise stabilizer subgroup of the fixed point subspace VH should be H. So here it's like if you have V1 and here 1. VH, H, like that. So so this is interesting. In fact, there is a way, you have this way to completely characterize this notion of weakly cyclic, which comes from subfactor plan algebra, in terms of group and representation. So this provide, so let's call an interval linearly primitive if you have this property. So you generalize the notion of linear primitivity to interval using this definition. And now you get a statement which is purely group theoretical. You use this theorem, prove for subfactor plan algebra. You use this characterization of weakly cyclic, and you get a dual version of Hoare's theorem. This is a dual version of this theorem. This is a dual version of relative Hoare's theorem. Dual version. So this is very, I want to develop a point here. This is in that sense that the framework of subfactor plan algebra is very interesting, because you can get natural, you have a natural way to produce dual version of theorem. You have a theorem on group theory, and if you can generalize it to subfactor plan algebra, and then you apply to the dual subfactor. This is the dual subfactor of this. Both are dual. So you have this duality in subfactor plan algebra. If you can generalize a theorem about group. You have a theorem about group, for example, Hoare's theorem. And if you can generalize it to subfactor plan algebra, then you can formulate a relative version by considering intermediate, and you can formulate a dual by considering the dual subfactor plan algebra. And then you can come back to group, and you can formulate it purely in terms of group framework by providing some translation. So it's a very deep tool to provide natural relative version and natural dual version of theorem in group theory. So sometimes perhaps it's not so easy, perhaps it's not possible to provide a The generalization of a theorem in group theory, for example, it looks very complicated or even unreachable to, for example, generalize the classification of finite simple group in terms of subfactor plan algebra. Or perhaps this will be done perhaps in 1,000 years, I don't know. But for some theorem of combinatorial flavor, there is a good chance for such theorem to be extended to subfactor plan algebra. So there is a good chance to be able to provide relative version and dual version and dual version of the relative version, etc., etc. So there is it's a good point. In my opinion, people which are purely group theorists should learn more about subfactor planar algebra. In fact, this theorem, so it's a direct corollary of this theorem proved in the framework of subfactor planar algebra. But I also wrote a paper in the framework of group theory reproving this corollary, purely in the framework of group theory. So, what about some extra application? So this is already an application to group theory, but let's provide some extra application. So this next application we will use will consider some chain of biprojection like that. So let's consider a subfactor plan algebra P and the minimal number of minimal projection generating the identity by projection. Or if you want the minimal number of minimal projection component of a positive operator generating the identity by projection is at most the minimal length L for a chain as below, for a chain like that, such that any component correspond to a top Boolean interval. So it's a corollary. It's not that immediate, but you need to use this theorem. So prove for top Boolean subfactor plan algebra. And with some extra lemma, you can get that and what about the reformulation of that in the framework of group theory? In the framework of group theory, you have the following. You have the cross product subfactor plan algebra and the fixed point dual to each other, so you have two results. The minimal size of a generating set of a group G is at most the minimal length L of a chain such that any intermediate, the interval is top Boolean. So this interval, top Boolean, top Boolean, top Boolean. And the minimal length of such chain is a bound for the minimal size of a generating set of a group. And what about the dual version of that? So the dual version, as we know it, deal with representation. The minimal number of irreducible components for a faithful representation of G is at most the minimal length of such a chain, but we need to replace top Boolean by bottom Boolean because it's the dual. So in the dual, the lattice is reversed. So what was top Boolean now is bottom Boolean. So this version, the relative dual version, and thanks to that, in fact, you can get an extra result for a group. This is the result, not for an interval. Using the result for interval, you can apply the result for interval to get a result for a group. And this is a first link. We will see another one soon between combinatorics and representation theory. So the minimal number of irreducible components for a faithful complex representation of a group, this is an invariant coming from representation theory, and it is bounded by an invariant coming from combinatorics. It is a purely combinatorial invariant. So this is purely combinatorial. You can improve a bit this bound by introducing an extra assumption, which is no more purely combinatorial. You get a better bound if you assume IH0, if H0 is not necessarily one, but a core-free subgroup of H1. Then if you consider the minimal length of such chain where you allow H0 to be any core-free subgroup of H1, you have more choice, so the minimal, in fact, is strictly smaller in general. This is strictly better. But it's no more strictly combinatorial because you introduce this notion of core-free, which deal with normal subgroup. So if you only know the subgroup lattice, but if you don't know the normal subgroup structure, you have this result, which is purely combinatorial. But if you know also the normal subgroup, then you must apply this better bound. Now we will. So the title of the topic of this part is quantum arithmetic. So here we saw a way to generalize the notion of prime number and of natural number, and we find the properties for this generalization of natural number, distributive subfactor plane algebra, are weakly cyclic. And we get several applications to finite group theory. So we discussed a lot of group theory. Let's come back to arithmetic. A bit more of arithmetic. So this is one of the most famous arithmetic function, the Euler's totient function. So, the Euler totient function, which is the Euler totient function of an integer n, is the number of integers less than n, which are prime with n, positive integer. So it's one of the most famous arithmetic functions. The first step to generalize such function to subfactor plane algebra is to generalize it for group. So trivially, the Euler totient of a group is a number of elements which generate the group. So here we have to be careful. There is a possible confusion. Here, it's a number of elements which generate the group individually, in fact. And here, what we said, the minimal number of elements generating the group, this is the minimal number in the sense of the minimal size of a generating set. It has for here the minimal size of a set of minimal projection generating the biprojection. So you have to be careful, minimal size of generating set, size of a generating set. Here, this is the size of element to generate the group individually. So this is Euler totient of a group. And so obviously it is non-zero if and only if the group is singly generated by definition. And the group singly generated cyclic group. And this is exactly the Euler totient function. So this is straightforward. The better step here is to generalize that for inclusion of finite group. This will provide a better help for our generalization to subfactor planar algebra. So, if you have an inclusion of finite group, the Euler totient of this inclusion denoted phi hg is the number of cosets hg generating g. So we use, this is a relative version of that. In fact, this is the same as we see in some previous slides. We see that we already use the coset for a relative version of singly generated. Here we use the same. So the number of coset generating G, H coset. And this is by definition the Euler totient of this interval, this inclusion of group. And using, we will reformulate this Euler totient in using lattice and Mobius function of the lattice. And in fact, the Mobius function can be defined for any finite coset. So this is a definition of a Mobius function. So it's quite natural. We will come back to this definition. We'll provide an equivalent definition in the next slide. So let's see this definition. So the Mobius function of a finite poset, on a finite poset, is defined inductively like that. So you take two elements in the poset, two elements AB with A less than or equal to B. And you say that the Mobius function mu AB is one if A equal B. Otherwise, you define it inductively by considering elements
C, which are strictly closer to B, like that, minus the sum of C, which are between A and B, but not B, of mu CB. You see that this reduces the distance between the distance between C and B is smaller than the distance between A and B. We deal with finite poset. The distance is a poset, the picture. So this provides you can make a well-defined inductive definition like that. So this is in fact easy to play with. In fact, you take any poset, any lattice, you can play with this definition and you can provide the Mobius function like that inductively. So you don't need to worry about that. It's very natural and very easy to play with. All prove in 36 that the relative Euler quotient can be reformulated in terms of lattice and Mobius function. So the Euler quotient of the East inclusion HC is the sum over all the elements of this interval, all the subgroup between H and G of mu kg index of H in K. So this is very natural, very easy to state and prove by Hall in 36. And let's note first that, in fact, this is non-zero if and only if the interval is weakly cyclic, H-check by definition, in fact. So we touch something, we will come back to this notion of weakly cyclic. In fact, we will get another statement with weakly cyclic using the Euler quotient function, Euler quotient on surfactor plane algebra. But as I said, let's provide a reformulation of the Mobius function definition. In fact, the Mobius function can be represented using Boolean lattice. It's called the Boolean representation of the Mobius function. And the theorem stating that is called the cross-cut theorem. You can find, I don't know who proved that in the first time, but you can find this theorem in the book of Richard Stanley, the book Enumerative Combinatorics, Volume 1. So the let L be a finite lattice and A1 up to AN, the coatom of L. So let's recall that the coatom are the maxima when you remove the one hat, the maximum here. You remove the maximum, and the maxima of the poset when you remove the maximum one hat is the coatom. So it's finite, so you have finitely many coatoms. Let's denote A1 up to AN, the coatom of L. And consider the order reversing map. So here, you have a lattice, the Boolean lattice. And this is another lattice, but the map reverses. Reverse the order. And as we said,
the Boolean lattice is the lattice of subset of the set from 1 to n. So any element of the Boolean lattice is a set I, the subset of 1 to n. So you can denote it I. And the map, so mi, is 1 hat, so the top element if I is empty. Otherwise, it is the it is the mid of all the coatom with index I in I, for the mid for all I, small I in being I of AI, like that. So this is how this map is defined. And then for any element in the finite lattice L, the modulus function mu a 1 hat can be is equal to this alternating sum, so the sum of minus 1 power the order of I, sum over all the I which are in the inverse of the map for this singleton A. So there is they can have several possible interval I, so that this is A, and all such I, you make the sum over all such I, and you make minus 1 power the order of A. And this will give you the Mobius function. So this is very useful for our need, because as we said in our topic, the key object is the key object are the Boolean lattice. And here there is a way to reformulate a notion using Boolean lattice. So this will be very useful for our need. So you can define for every A, B like that by taking interval but let note that this map is neither injective nor surjective. So if an element A is not rich, so it's not in the image, then this will be zero, because it's a sum, an empty sum, it's zero. For example, if you take an element which is out of the top interval, by definition, the image of that will be not exactly the how to say that? The image of that will is contained in the top interval. It is contained in the top interval. So if it is out of the top interval, it is zero. But it can be also zero in the top interval. You can have some element in the top interval which is not rich also. For example, let's see that as an exercise. Find
a lattice so that, such that there is an element in the top interval which is not reached. So you go to, you can find an example like that if you, for example, perhaps in some lattice I already shown before. Anyway, so it's easy. Okay, so out of the top interval in particular, this is zero. Because it's an empty sum. And it's so it's neither injective nor surjective in general, but it's bijective if and only if M is Boolean of rank N also. And in this case, in fact, this is exactly, so if you take A equal the complement of I, what you get is just reduced to just minus one power order of I. So here it's I complement and here is I. So in the Boolean case, the Mobius function is straightforward. You just have plus or minus like that. So, now we can generalize. So we can directly generalize the Euler totient to subfactor plane algebra using Hall's theorem. We assume the surfactor to be irreducible, surfactor plane algebra. We already said that a surfactor related to a surfactor plane algebra is of finite index because the n box space are finite dimensional. And by Watt-Attani's theorem, finite index irreducible is finite lattice. So we can define for irreducible surfactor plane algebra, it's a finite lattice by projection lattice. So this sum is a finite sum. So it directly extends the sum coming from Hall's theorem. And this will be our definition of Euler totient. Let's mention here that we cannot generalize Euler totient using the number of something, because here everything is this is commutative. There is the two box space corresponding to that is commutative, and you can define some number, but in the non-commutative case, if the two box space is non-commutative, the number of elements which will generate the biprojection are infinitely many, because if you deal with non-commutative, this can be generated by minimal projection, but this can be generated by many, many minimal projection in a non-commutative matrix algebra. You can have infinitely many. So this is a good way to generalize the notion of Euler totient for every irreducible surfactor plane algebra, even if the two box space is non-commutative. This is a good way. We will see later that in some cases, we can come back to this to counting something or to measuring something, but in general, this is a good way. So we have, this is fantastic. Fantastic. The notion of surfactor plane algebra is a notion which is very general, very deep, very symmetric, quantum symmetry. This is very vast, very, very complicated. We cannot expect to classify every surfactor plane algebra. And the notion of Euler-Tolchian function is a notion, it's an arithmetic function, notion, it's a notion for natural number. And this is a generalization of this arithmetic function for natural number to every irreducible subfactor plane algebra. This is very, very interesting, very good. You have you have this quantum, another way to show that the notion quantum arithmetic makes sense. In fact, this is defined for every subfactor plane algebra, irreducible subfactor plane algebra, and we will see that this will deal. So quantum arithmetic, we said that this corresponds to extending properties of natural number to distributive subfactor plane algebra. And we will see that the distributive subfactor plane algebra will deal with that. We can state some very deep conjecture generalizing the properties of the Euler-Tolchian function for natural number. So arithmetic, quantum arithmetic makes sense, really makes sense. So here, the usual Euler-Tolchian function applied to a natural number, you have this formula. So if this is a prime factorization of a natural number, then the Euler-Tolchian function of n is like that. You have the two components in this product, the product of pi power ni minus 1 and the power times the product of pi minus 1 like that. And this result decomposition in two components like that, you can state it, this generalized to subfactor plane algebra directly using the notion of top interval. So the notion of top interval is also fundamental, in fact. So if you have a subfactor plane algebra P, irreducible, and this is the biprojection lattice, this is a top interval, then the Euler-Tolchian of P is like that. So the index of T, so this index corresponding to that, and this Euler-Tolchian function for this, the top interval corresponding to that. And this is an exact generalization. So if you restrict to the cyclic groups of factor plane algebra, this recover exactly that. This is an exact generalization. And finally, the result is that. So this result exact it's the generalization of that. So you have the Euler-Tolchian function is a number of coset generalized. So there's something, the number of coset generalizing G. So in particular, it is non-zero. If it's non-zero, then there is a coset generalizing G, as I said here. So this is non-zero if and only if it is acyclic. And as for our theorem, we generalize one way, and the other way is open. But one way, if it is non-zero, then it is weakly cyclic. So if the Euler-Tolchian of P is non-zero, then P is weakly cyclic. And the other way, how to generalize the other way, is still open. So so as for the Horst theorem, as I said, the use of subfactor plane algebra is a good way to provide dual version of result of group. And here, we will provide the dual version of one way of that. So using this definition for the group subgroups of factor plane algebra for the fixed point case, if you state, if you write the Euler torsion for that, you get in terms of the group framework, you get a dual version of the Euler torsion of the interval. So you have the Euler torsion for the group, for an inclusion of group, which is here, and going through the factor plane algebra, you get a natural dual version. This is almost the same thing, but not exactly. You have new HK index GK, and here you have new KG index KH. So you have some permutation, it's a reverse in some sense, it's reversed. And as before, so you applied application to group theory. If this dual torsion is non-zero, then the interval is linearly primitive in the sense defined before, in particular, when H is trivial group. This dual torsion defined with H equal one, trivial, is non-zero, then if it is non-zero, then G is linearly primitive, G admits a faithful, irreducible complex representation. So, very nice. So you have so it's similar to what we did for our theorem. So here, at the group level, you have this completely combinatorial invariant, the dual Euler torsion of the group, and you see it is at the representation level, it's singly generated. There is an irreducible faithful representation. I did not mention here, but this representation generates a representation. The faithful representation generates every representation up to equivalence by using the tensor product. So the product of a group, the dual version of a product, the dual version of an element is an irreducible representation, and the dual version of the product of element is the tensor product of representation. So this means that G is dually singly generated. It's generated in the dual sense, linearly primitive. And so, this is in linearly primitive, is in some sense the dual version of the notion of cyclic group. Okay. Now, this is one way, but the other way is the converse is false. If you consider the group called the modular maximal cyclic group, M42, which is of order 16, this group is linearly primitive, but its dual Euler torsion is equal to zero. So as I said, even at the group level, the generalization of the equivalence is still open. Only one way is generalized. So we get the same application as before with the chain, where now you replace top Boolean and bottom Boolean by non-zero Euler torsion. And what I wrote here, in fact, I wrote without at most in the group case. So here we have, it's when you have in the usual case, this is a dual case, group case, it's at most the minimal length. So the minimal size of the generating size is at most the minimal blah 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 top boolean. When you put replace top boolean by Euler totient, it's no more at most, it is equal. So the minimal size of a generating set is equal to the minimal length, blah, 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 Euler totient, non-zero Euler totient. So, but in the dual case, it's not equal. You keep at most in the dual case. And in the dual case, you'll be replaced top boolean by also non-zero dual Euler totient. But you cannot remove the at most. Okay, so this is the other application of the quantum arithmetic to finite group theory. What about the Euler totient of Boolean subfactor plane algebra? So we call distributive subfactor plane algebra the subfactor plane algebra with distributive by projection lattice. So a Boolean subfactor plane algebra is a subfactor plane algebra with a Boolean by projection lattice. And here is a conjecture which is stated in the framework of subfactor planar algebra. But this was stated also in another paper with Mamta Balodi for group. So you have the analogous, the same conjecture for group with Mamta Balodi, but in the framework of subfactor plan, for subfactor plan algebra, the conjecture says that the Euler totient theorem is stronger than the Ors theorem on subfactor plan algebra, which in other words mean that the conjecture says that a Boolean subfactor plan algebra, if the biprojection lattice is Boolean, then the Euler totient is non-zero. In that sense, this is the conjecture, which means that the Euler totient theorem here is stronger than, where is it? This one. Stronger. So this is the question, the conjecture. We conjecture that if the biprojection lattice is Boolean, then the Euler totient is non-zero. So let provide a stronger version of that. Let consider the golden ratio, and in fact, the question is, in the Boolean case of rank n plus 1, is it true that the Euler totient is greater than or equal to the golden ratio power n? In particular, it's non-zero. But this is a stronger version of the non-zero-ness. In the rank n plus 1 case, is it greater than or equal to the golden ratio power n? And if it is correct, in fact, it is optimal because realized by this subfactor plane algebra, the temporally elliptic subfactor plane algebra with parameter root 2, so index 2, and the subfactor plane algebra, temporally elliptic subfactor plane algebra, temporally elliptic Jones with parameter the golden ratio, so golden ratio square index, and tensor and time. So it's it Euler totient is, so it's a result, it's not completely straightforward, its Euler-Toshunt is exactly the golden ratio power n. This can be proved using a paper of Feng Shu about the tensor product of subfactor. In fact, yeah, in my first paper on the subject published in the Pacific Journal of Mathematics, there is a theorem using a paper of Feng Shu from which we can deduce that the Euler-Toshunt in this case is equal to that. Anyway, so is it true? Is it not true? Here is a model. So this is a model that I don't know any subfactor parallel algebra with this model, corresponding to this model. But if there is a subfactor parallel algebra with a biprojection lattice which is Boolean of rank 3 and such that the indices of every biprojection are like that, then I don't have any way to rule out this to exist, but I don't have any example of this. But if this exists, then the Euler-Toshunt, as we said in the Boolean case, so the Euler-Toshunt is defined using the Mobius function, and in the Boolean case, the Mobius function is just a plus, minus, 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 plus, 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 minus. So the Euler-Toshunt here is just this minus this, minus this, minus this, plus this, plus this, minus this, and you can check that for the golden ratio, this is equal to zero. So this would be a counterexample for this conjecture, but we don't know any example satisfying that, and also we don't know a way to exclude that. So perhaps if you know a way to make a subfactor plane algebra from a lattice, in fact, this can be possible. Well, using the embedding theorem, I said in some previous video, we can make subfactor plane algebra from a principal graph. So why not making subfactor plane algebra from a lattice? So perhaps there is analogous of the embedding theorem of Jones Penis for the lattice. You start from a lattice and you with the index like that, and you make a planar algebra, and if there is a subfactor planar algebra with this lattice and these indices, it should be included like that inside. And so perhaps there is a way to make such an example, or at least to rule it out if there is no subfactor plane algebra in this potential lattice subfactor plane algebra, analogous of the principal of the bipartite graph subfactor plane algebra. Why not? Interesting. So at the group level, this question, you have a stronger version of this question here. The golden ratio is 1.6. You can get a stronger version if you restrict to the group level, like the dual, with dual Euler-Toshunt. We stated this conjecture, this question, so in the paper with Mamta Balodi, so we can replace the golden ratio by 2, so it's stronger. And again, if it is correct, it is optimal because realized by this interval of group using the symmetric group and some product. So this is a question stronger at the group level stated for in the paper with Mamta Balodi. So question, this is a question. And in fact, in a 2 years later, in a paper in collaboration, Lucchini, Moscatiello, and Spiga, we were able to answer this question positively in that cases. So it's far from being the general cases. Here I forgot to mention it's okay. So in these cases, this is true. So let's read these cases. So if it is true, if it is Boolean of rank 3 or less than or equal to 3. So this is combinatorial proof here. It is true if the Boolean interval is group complemented. So Boolean, in some sense, is lattice complemented, but it's not always group complemented. And group complemented mean here. So for every element in the interval, it commutes with its complement. So in particular, k complement is equal to g. It's the exercise. So in this case, which is not always true, this is satisfied, this is proved. It is also proved if g is solvable. So here it's a huge class. This is true if g is solvable. And it is also true if g is alternating or symmetric. This was the main point of this paper, to classify all the Boolean interval with g symmetric or alternating. And using this classification, we can prove that. And finally, it is proved, it is true, if g is a simple group of Lie type and h the Borel subgroup of g. Here there is I would like to prove that in general for at the subfactor plane algebra level in general, but this can be perhaps this is true, but this could be very hard. But this one is more easy to reach, but this one can be very hard. And in fact, this provides a new land of problem to solve in group theory. You can try to prove that for more cases and finally for the general cases. Is there an elementary proof, an abstract proof, which do not use the classification of finite simple group? This is what we want, because otherwise we cannot have a proof for the general case, subfactor plane algebra. If we need the classification of finite simple group to prove that in general, then as long as we do not generalize the classification of finite simple group to any subfactor plane algebra, we cannot expect the existence of a general proof here. I don't know if there is a general proof. I hope so, but perhaps it's not so easy. this one may be more easy to reach. Anyway, so it's interesting because you see here some application of the quantum arithmetic, of this idea coming from this easy idea, we want to generalize the notion of prime number and natural number to soft factor plane algebra, and we want to generalize the properties of the natural number. This can look naive, but you see now there are a lot of applications, and this provides, in fact, a big land of new open problem for group theory, and we can expect. So here we saw a lot of application already, and we can expect that this idea of quantum arithmetic will provide in the future many, many good ideas, many, many new applications to group theory, or to number theory, and to get a better understanding of the general theory of subfactors. So this is concrete. This is not it's not a dream of something. Anyway, so here. We can state a subfactor planar algebra generalization of the notion of a conjecture due to Brown. So there is a Brown conjecture. In fact, to be more precise, there is a question of Brown about non-contractibility of some space coming from finite group. I will explain here, there is a stronger version using the non-zeroness of some Euler characteristic, which it is called the Brown conjecture. But here, there is a way to generalize this Brown conjecture. So exactly this is, let P be an irreducible subfactor plane algebra, then its reduced Euler characteristic defined here is non-zero in general. This look like to the Euler torsion, but it's not exactly. If you look carefully, in fact, you see that Euler torsion here, you have mu b identity b e1. Here it's, you have a minus here, it's b identity b. So you have it's another notion. And this notion generalizes the notion of Euler characteristics. Fantastic. The notion of the use of biprojection lattice and Mobius function, you can generalize the Euler torsion, the Euler characteristic. It's a really a new land of mathematics. There are many, many things to do. Many, we can expect many good theorems. It's so natural how to generalize the notion of Euler characteristics. It's good. So why it's a generation? In what sense it's a generation of the Euler characteristic? And this should be non-zero always. So So I will explain in what sense it generates the Euler characteristic. But the usual Brown conjecture corresponds to the group subfactor plane algebra, the cross product case. So you can define the Euler characteristic like that. And this was proved by Gachutz for G solvable. So the name, Euler characteristic, comes from the fact that in the group case, this is exactly the Euler characteristic of the order complex of the poset of all cosets of all proper subgroup of G, order by inclusion. So you need to focus a bit on this statement, but nothing complicated here. You have from a group, you can consider every subgroup and every proper subgroup and every coset for every subgroup, and this make a you can make a poset for that. And in algebraic combinatorics, there is a notion of order complex for a poset. And in fact, every topological variety, can be you can do some triangularization. So there is a way to make an order complex, to make a poset. So there is from every topological variety you can make a poset whose order complex is isomorphic to, and from a group you can make a poset, and the space you get from this poset using subgroup and coset, the order complex, the Euler characteristic of that is exactly that, is equal to that. I don't know if you can modelize every topological space as isomorphic to the order complex coming from group like that. Perhaps, I don't know, perhaps it's a conjecture, I don't know. But you can expect that, perhaps it's true, I don't know. So in that sense, this generalizes the notion of Euler characteristic. Let's now see in what sense this is related to what we said before. In what sense, so as we said, the Euler characteristic is very close to the Euler totient, but not exactly the same. But in what sense, in which case it is the same? And in what sense this can be connected to what we said before? So first, if you consider a subfactor plane algebra, we said there is one n-box space is defined with plus or minus. If you exchange plus and minus, you get another subfactor plane algebra, which is a dual one. So if you exchange plus and minus, it's also a subfactor plane algebra called the dual subfactor plane algebra. And then the biprojection lattice is reversed. In fact, this is the dual in the sense of what we already said before. The subfactors are dual each other. And so, for example, in the group case, you have the cross product and the fixed point dual to each other. So this is exactly the same notion here. So Brown conjecture as stated here extend the Euler totient conjecture stated here, because if the biprojection lattice is Boolean, then the Euler characteristic is equal to the Euler totient of the dual up to a sign, because the Mobius function of E1B is equal to the Mobius function of B identity times this sign. As we said, this is due to the fact that in the Boolean case, the Mobius function is just a sign like that. So you have that in the Boolean case. In the Boolean case, the Euler characteristic is equal to the Euler totient of the dual up to a sign. And in fact, you disuse that. In fact, this holds more generally for what is called an Eulerian lattice. Eulerian lattice, which generalizes the notion of Boolean lattice. An Eulerian lattice is a lattice which is graded as for a Boolean lattice, as such that the Möbius function AB is equal to minus one power the grade of B minus the grade of A, where A is less than B. So this is true for Boolean lattice, but there are some lattices which are Boolean which satisfy that. So the Eulerian lattices is a strictly greater class of lattices. So the rank, this is a rank function, the graded lattice. And we can, so the Brown conjecture was already an extension of Euler totient, but you can use Euler totient conjecture. Using that, you can provide a conjecture. You can make a closer conjecture by replacing Boolean by Eulerian. So if the biprojection lattice is Eulerian, then the Euler totient is non-zero. And by using our theorem, this will imply that the subfactor plane algebra is weakly cyclic. So this will extend the Hoare's theorem also from top Boolean to top Eulerian. So the Brown conjecture extends the Euler totient conjecture, and the Euler totient conjecture says that the Euler totient theorem is stronger than the Hoare's theorem. And using that, you get an closer extension. You get an extension of Hoare's theorem from top Boolean to top Eulerian. Okay. What are examples of Eulerian lattices? In fact, the generic example, not generic, but there is a large class of examples of Eulerian lattices given by convex polytope. So the face lattice, so I do not define in detail what is a face lattice here, but you can find it on the web, on Wikipedia. The face lattice of any convex polytope is Eulerian. In fact, you have an example here. The face lattice, the face lattice of the square polytope. This is an Eulerian lattice. Why? So here there is another application, in fact, a potential application to subfactor theory. You have this Watatani's lattice representation problem. We already mentioned, is there a model coming from subfactor for every lattice? Is every lattice, finite lattice, the intermediate subfactor lattice, or if you prefer, the biproject lattice, a biprojection lattice? So here, let's mention a theorem in group. So an Eulerian subgroup lattice, finite group, is always Boolean. So we know that there are Boolean Eulerian lattices that are not Boolean. So in particular, this cannot be the subgroup lattice of a finite group. because this proposition proves that any Eulerian subgroup lattice is Boolean. So this cannot be a subgroup lattice. But this proposition, we don't know if it extends to interval. In fact, if it extends to interval, this will solve the analogous of Watatani's problem for group, subgroup, because this will be not given by an interval of group, but it is not known whether this can be extended to interval, but we don't know any counterexample, but we can expect this to be true, and this provide counterexample. The extension to any irreducible surfactor plane algebra is there, an irreducible surfactor plane algebra which an Eulerian by projection lattice which is not Boolean. We don't know. So this, if you can prove that any Eulerian surfactor plane algebra is Boolean, then this will solve Watatani's problem. This will provide this as a counterexample of Watatani's problem. But it's not, we don't know. We don't know if it is true or not. This is the smallest non-abelian Eulerian lattice. So this is a potential counterexample of Watatani's theorem. In fact, we don't know if it exists. And here, exactly as before, as we mentioned here, is there a way to generate, to make a lattice planar algebra as for principal graph planar algebra, as for the embedding theorem, the Jones-Penney theorem? Can we generate a planar algebra such that every possible subfactorial planar algebra should be included in this big planar algebra generated by this lattice? Is it possible to do that? It's a question. I don't know. This is a problem. In fact, this is an idea how to solve such problem. If we can do that, this will be fantastic, and we can make a new surfactor plane algebra or prove that there is no for that, and this would solve this problem. So there are a lot of potential new results in application to quantum arithmetic. So the last two slides now let's take Let dream, if you want. Up to now, everything is published, everything is well defined, everything is okay. You have some concrete application, you have some concrete expectation of new result. The last two slides, let's allow us to dream. So the last two slides will be about Riemann hypothesis. So the star, the big star of arithmetic, the Riemann hypothesis, the biggest conjecture. Surprisingly, there is a way to extend the Riemann hypothesis to subfactor planar algebra. So it's still a dream in the sense that we don't know if this can help, or if we can prove something here, or if what I will explain here is obviously false, or obviously equivalent to Riemann hypothesis, or we don't know if it is useful or not. but let allow us to dream. And let me explain how to generalize the Riemann hypothesis to subfactor planar algebra. This will be what we call the quantum Riemann hypothesis. So how is it possible to do that? We cannot do that using the zeta function. We need an elementary reformulation of the Riemann hypothesis and an elementary representation, reformulation, which in some sense can use lattice or And there exists such a reformulation, in fact, due to Robin. So let's recall what is the divisor function. The divisor function of a natural number is the sum over all the divisors. The sum over all the divisors, this is related to the subgroup lattice of a cyclic group, because I recall you that there is a 1-1 correspondence between the divisor of an element and the subgroup of a cyclic group. In fact, it's a theorem that a group is cyclic if and only if there exists a unique subgroup of order d for every d dividing n. The theorem characterizing the cyclic group. If there is a 1-1 correspondence between the subgroup and the divisor of the order of the group, given by such that the subgroup order is this divisor, then it's cyclic. It's a characterization of cyclic. So it can be also some new idea to get our to get new results. As for Horst's theorem, here we have another characterization of cyclic group. Distributive lattice is a characterization of cyclic group. What I just said is a characterization of cyclic group. There exist many, many other results characterizing the cyclic group, in fact. But also exists results characterizing the abelian group. There is a finite group is abelian if and only if the subgroup lattice of the group product with itself is modular. Very close to our theorem, but for abelian, you take a group G, you make G square. The subgroup lattice of G square is modular if and only if the group is abelian, and modular is a property of lattice I do not define here. But let's come back to Robin reformulation or reformulation of Riemann hypothesis. So you have this divisor function, and the theorem, due to, I don't know, in fact, if you know the reference for who proved that first, you can let me know in comment. So if you consider the Euler Matironi constant, the Euler constant, usual Euler constant, then theorem says that the limb sup for n to infinity of the divisor function divided by n log log n, this limb sup is exactly the exponential of the Euler constant, like that, gamma. So it's a theorem of number theory. And Robin was able to reformulate Riemann hypothesis like that, in fact. The Riemann hypothesis is true if and only for n large enough, so it's not true for small n, but if only for n large enough, you have the divisor function is bounded by that. So, coming from that, we put that here. And if for n large enough, the Dither function is bounded by that. This is the equivalent to the Riemann hypothesis. Fantastic. It's, so the Riemann hypothesis, whose statement is a bit complicated, use the zeta function and the zeta function and some you need to extend it to the complex plane using some functional equation. So it's not at all straightforward how to state the Riemann hypothesis for the non-trivial zero, which are in the imaginary part one half. But here is an elementary way to reformulate the Riemann hypothesis. And in fact, in my opinion, this I don't know if I should say that, but this should be the initial way to formulate the Riemann hypothesis. This is the easiest way to formulate the Riemann hypothesis. In fact, this should be the Riemann hypothesis, and the properties with zeta function and zero of and the connection with prime, etc., should be a corollary of that, a consequence of that. I don't know, anyway. It does not matter, but this is, in my knowledge, the easiest way and the more elementary way to reformulate the Riemann hypothesis. And this is very useful because here, everything reduced to some lattices, this is quite easy to, using this reformulation, to generalize to sub-factor planar algebra. So here, P is denote an irreducible sub-factor planar algebra, and let's call module of P like that, the index. So we need first to generalize the divisor function. So you have the divisor function here. Here you have the divisor. And here the divisor, the set of divisor, will be generalized as the set of all the index of the biprojection. Index B, E1, like that. You take the set of that, and this set is generalized the divisor function. In the cyclic group case, this is exactly the same thing. And you take the sum over all the element of this set. So this generalizes the divisor function on subfactor plan algebra. So again, a new tool, a new arithmetic function extended to subfactor plan algebra. A new tool for our quantum arithmetic. Let call FR the set of irreducible subfactor plan algebra of depth R. So we already defined what is the depth of a subfactor, and we said that this can be defined in the framework of subfactor plan algebra. So the set of all the irreducible subfactor plan algebra of depth R up to equivalence, let's denote this set like that. And to state a generalization of the Riemann hypothesis, we need these two steps. First, the first part of the conjecture said that there may exist a constant omega r such that the limit sup of over the subfactor plan algebra of the irreducible subfactor plan algebra of depth R. The limit sup when the index go to infinity of that. So the divisor function of the subfactor plan algebra divided by its index time log log of its index equal to exponential omega r. Gamma r, so exactly here, like here. And, so first part and second part for that, for index large enough, for a subfactor for algebra of depth R irreducible, you have this bound exactly like here. So the divisor function of P is less than exponential of gamma R index of P times log log P. So this is how to generalize the Riemann hypothesis to subfactor plan algebra, and this is called the quantum Riemann hypothesis of depth R. We take R greater than or equal to 2. And straightforwardly, by the Galois correspondence, because at irreducible depth 2, everything is integer, and it's very easy to see that gamma 2 equals gamma. And the quantum Riemann hypothesis of depth 2 is equivalent to the Riemann hypothesis. So this is a dream, but the way to state the conjecture is well written. There is no ambiguity here. Now, I don't know. I don't prove anything about that. I don't know if this is if it is trivially false, or I don't know if it is trivially equivalent to the Riemann hypothesis for all depth. I don't know if this can help to prove the Riemann hypothesis, or if it is. So I don't know if the planar algebra framework can help to prove that in general, and then you can apply to depth 2 and you get the Riemann hypothesis. I don't know if this can help in some sense. What I only know is that this can be stated. This is well written. And you can dream it can be useful or not. So I don't say anything more than that. Okay. So let's finish this talk with this dream. Thank you for listening, and bye. Bye bye.